In today's video, we'll be explaining a seemingly simple but often confusing conundrum involving vehicular brakes and tires. If you have ever considered upgrading your vehicle's brakes and did a bit of research online, then you have probably found out that, contrary to intuition, bigger brakes will not reduce your braking distance. On the other hand, we all know that wider tires can improve both your braking and your cornering performance. So the underlying question we're answering today is, why does surface area matter with tires but not with brakes? If this is your first time hearing about it, then you're probably surprised to learn that increasing the size of your brake discs and your brake calipers and brake pads will not reduce your braking distance. This is contrary to intuition because we believe that by making the pad and the disc larger, we give the pad more surface area onto which it can grab, which is going to increase friction and improve braking performance and stop the car sooner. We can make an analogy to a wooden plank that we're pushing along the floor. Again, intuition tells us that if we're pushing the plank on its side, it's going to be easier than if we had to push the plank on its face. Again, we believe that reduced surface area leads to reduced friction, and thus we need less strength or less force to get the object moving. But physics disagrees with intuition, and physics says this. Yes, it's a formula, but don't get scared. It's the simplest formula there is, and tells us that frictional force, F, equals the Greek letter mu or mu, different people pronounce it differently. It's basically the coefficient of friction times the normal force. Let's explain what this means. Frictional force is obviously the amount of friction. The higher the frictional force, the more friction we have to overcome, and the harder it will be to get the object moving. The coefficient of friction is a constant, and it depends on the nature of the material and surface roughness. For example, sandpaper has a much higher coefficient of friction than glass. And normal force, that's the force acting on the object, pressing it down against the surface. On a stationary object that lies on a flat surface, the normal force is going to be the weight of the object pressing it down against the surface. As you can see, there's no surface area in the formula. Physics doesn't care if the object is on its side or on its face. Even if the difference in surface area is quite dramatic, the frictional force remains the same. And this is because the weight of the object remains the same and the material is the same no matter how we place the object on the surface. So why is this the case? Well, to understand this properly, we have to zoom in a bit. And if you took a microscope and looked at the surfaces of all the objects around you, you would see that what seems as very smooth to the naked eye is not smooth under a microscope. Instead, it's all jagged and full of peaks and valleys. Even surfaces are like glass, which you would guarantee that are smooth, are actually all rough and jagged under a microscope. Now, when we take two surfaces and place them against each other, the peaks or the asperities of each surface area are making contact, they're rubbing against each other or interlocking, if you will, while the valleys of each surface, they never make contact. And this is why it's very important to distinguish between apparent and actual contact area. Now, when we take a wooden plank and place it on a table, to the naked eye, it seems that the entire face of the plank is touching the table. This is the apparent contact area. But on a microscopic level, the amount of the plank that is touching the table is only about 5% of the apparent contact area. This is the actual contact area, and it's so small because only the peaks of each surface are actually touching one another. How many peaks interlock and how much they interlock depends on the normal force. When we flip the object from its side to its face, the normal force remains the same because the weight of the object remains the same. Although we increase the number of peaks facing each other when we increase the surface area, we are also distributing the same force over the greater surface area, which means that the peaks interlock less. They touch each other less. This is why stabbing yourself with a needle is far more painful than doing the same thing with, let's say, a bottle cap. You may apply the exact same force in both scenarios, but in the case of the needle, all the force is concentrated on an extremely small surface area, leading to a much higher pressure. In the case of the bottle cap, the force gets distributed over a larger area, leading to reduced pressure. The same thing happens with our plank. Friction stays the same because we're offsetting the increased number of peaks with reduced pressure on the peaks since we're distributing the same force over a greater surface area. In other words, we're increasing the apparent contact area, but the actual contact area stays the same. But this formula or model doesn't mean that your intuition is wrong. And that is because physics models aren't meant to be an accurate representation of all instances of reality. Instead, they're just that. Models based on idealized assumptions. This model assumes that objects are perfectly flat and equally rough over their entire surface. In other words, it's assuming a repeating pattern of peaks and valleys over the entire objects. Objects like that do not exist in real life. Your intuition isn't wrong because it's based on actual experience of years of moving, lifting, and pushing various objects. If you were to go to a hardware store right now and buy any old plank or whatever, you know, and push it against the floor and then measured how much force it takes to get it moving when it's on its face versus on its side, you would see that it would likely require more force to get it moving when it's on its face. And this is because real life objects are neither perfectly flat nor equally rough over their entire surface. And this is why surface area often matters in real life. It matters because it reduces your chances of running into various surface imperfections or abnormalities, which increase friction. Okay, so the same thing then applies to brake discs and pads. They're imperfect surfaces, so the formula doesn't work. Actually, no. Brake pads and discs are machined very accurately, so they are pretty uniform over their entire surface, and the formula definitely works. Also, the way that the brake pad moves means that the application of force is very repeatable and linear, much more so than a human hand, which cannot apply the exact same force twice. So the formula definitely works, and increased surface area of brake discs and pads does not lead to increased friction. So the question is, why do then all the sports cars and race cars have these big brakes, which are obviously so much bigger than the brakes on normal cars? Well, the answer isn't increased friction. The answer is heat, or more precisely, the prevention of brake overheating. If you look at brakes more closely, you will see that many things in their design have to do with heat management. For example, the brakes of cars are tucked inside the wheel, and then the wheel is tucked inside the wheel arch or the body of the car, which means that the brakes aren't exposed to a lot of, you know, incoming air. In contrast to this, motorcycle brakes are sitting there directly in the stream of the incoming air. And this is why car brake discs are ventilated, but motorcycle brake discs are not. Ventilation works to try and evacuate as much of the heat as possible out of the braking system. Why is heat such a problem with brakes? Well, because it leads to brake fade. When brakes overheat, a thin layer of gas forms on the surface, and this layer of gas prevents proper braking. It leads to reduced friction and a loss of braking performance, otherwise known as brake fade. A larger brake disc and caliper is going to have a much larger surface over which heat can dissipate into the surrounding air, making this braking system much harder to overheat. So if you were to take two identical cars, one with stock brakes and the other one with upgraded brakes, and you take them to the track and drive them hard, they would brake equally well for the first 5 minutes. After that, the stock system will start to overheat and its braking performance will be dramatically reduced. On the other hand, the upgraded braking system might retain the same braking performance for an hour or two, or maybe even longer. In fact, the upgraded braking system might start braking better when it gets really hot, and it might brake worse than the stock system during the initial 5 minutes before it gets hot. And this is because different brake pad materials are designed for different temperature ranges. A material's temperature can have significant impact on its frictional capabilities, and it's almost impossible to get a material to be equally frictiony when both cold and hot. For example, racing brakes might be optimized for hot braking performance at the expense of cold braking, which isn't so important for race cars. On the other hand, stock brakes must offer optimal performance from the moment you start driving, but they do so at the expense of extreme temperature operation, which isn't achieved under normal driving circumstances anyway. So we have to correct our statement from before. Larger brake discs and pads will not reduce your braking distance under normal driving conditions. But if aggressive track driving is involved or stuff like towing increased loads, especially downhill, then upgrading your brakes might be necessary. Also, if you significantly increase the power output of your vehicle, making you capable of reaching much higher speeds much more quickly, and then you find yourself in a scenario where you have to repeatedly stop or slow down from these much higher speeds, then again, upgrading your brakes might be a good idea. So increased surface area with brakes doesn't increase friction. Instead, it increases the surface area available for heat dissipation with the goal of preventing reduced friction. Now, this formula works with brakes, obviously, but it does not work with tires. Over the years, many tests have been done and they have proven that increased tire width or size can improve braking performance and cornering performance. The question is, why? Why doesn't surface area matter with tires? Well, the answer is surprisingly obvious, and it's because brakes are solid and rigid, and tires are not. They're elastic because they're made from rubber after all. And also, brakes aren't designed to change shape or deform under normal operation. Tires change shape and deform all the time. The loads applied on brakes are simple and linear because the brake pad moves in only one direction. But the loads applied on tires are extremely complex and ever-changing. In fact, brakes are something called a simple solid. And this means that if we double the normal force or the load on the object, the actual contact area and thus the frictional force will double as well. In other words, the relationship between the load and frictional force is linear. Double the load is double the contact area, double the frictional force. But things work differently for tires. Because tires are made from rubber, they are soft and pliable. This means that the tire can conform to the material it's contacting and even reach the valleys which a solid material could not. This means that even a light load can increase the actual contact area and friction by a disproportionately high amount. On the other hand, increasing the load further leads to ever-reducing gains in actual contact area and friction. This is because the more load you apply to rubber, the stiffer it becomes, until it reaches a point where it can't become any stiffer. In other words, it takes a tremendous amount of force to push the rubber to reach the lowest parts of the valleys. You may have experienced this property of rubber yourself by trying to squeeze a rubber ball. The more you want to compress the ball, the harder it becomes to do so. There is very little resistance initially, but the more you squeeze, the stiffer the ball becomes and you have to apply ever more force for ever decreasing ball compression or shrinking. So with rubber and rubber tires, double the load does not mean double the actual contact area and friction. But this also means that half the load isn't half the friction. Now our load is the weight of the car pressing down on the tire, and our load remains the same. By installing wider / larger tires, you have spread out the same load over a larger surface area, leading to decreased pressure pushing the tire into the surface. But the reduction in pressure isn't offset by an equal reduction in actual contact area between surface asperities and the rubber. Because tires aren't solid, a 20% reduction in pressure doesn't result in a 20% reduction in actual contact area. The actual contact area reduces by only maybe 15 or 10%, for example. The end result is that a larger or wider tire has a greater actual contact area for the same load. And this property becomes ever more desirable and even more obvious when weight transfer and thus changing loads start acting on the tires during cornering and braking. But this isn't the only reason why sports cars and race cars have larger, wider tires. Heat management is again an important factor, and tires can also overheat, leading to increased wear and reduced performance. A larger, wider tire is obviously harder to overheat, just like a larger brake rotor is. Mechanical strength is also important. A wider tire, a bulkier tire can be made stronger, and this can help it resist deformation better, leading to more consistent performance. Another key factor is wear. You have probably noticed tire marks on roads or tracks or even entire chunks flying off during races. A larger, wider tire spreads out the wear over a greater surface and this helps it last longer. Seeing tire marks or actual parts of a tire that have remained stuck onto the road tells us just how important adhesion is for tires. Rubber is a material that is great at adhering to a large variety of surfaces, and the physics of adhesion are not the same as the physics of friction between two simple solids. This is why the instructions on GOES tell you to roughen up the surfaces that are about to be bonded. Roughing up a surface increases the surface area, and surface area definitely matters for adhesion. So wider tires can offer more grip and traction, but we also know that they usually have reduced performance in wet conditions. Why is that? Well, it's because increased actual contact area doesn't matter if there's a layer of water between the tire and the road surface. And when it comes to wider tires, water has to travel a greater distance until it's pushed out from under the tire, and contact between the tire and the road surface can be re-established. This is why narrower tires often perform better in wet and slippery conditions. The final very obvious evidence that surface area matters with tires, but not so much with brakes, is that race cars and sports cars often have slots or holes drilled in their brake rotors. This shows us that manufacturers are very much willing to sacrifice surface area in the interest of heat management and or debris evacuation. On the other hand, when motorsport vehicles want to go fast and have maximum grip in the dry, they're always going to go for slicks, and slick tires have no tread pattern, no grooves, nothing. Zero surface area is sacrificed in the interest of maximum contact area and thus friction and grip. Brakes and tires are seemingly simple, intuitive things. After all, it's just metal grabbing onto metal and rubber rolling on asphalt. But the science which deals with the mechanics of brakes, tires, and other forms of surface contact, friction, and lubrication is called tribology. And it's one of the most complex, mind-boggling scientific fields there is. This video barely manages to even scratch the surface of the incredible mechanics behind tire deformation and brakes and friction, but I hope that at least it manages to clear away some misconceptions and explain the basics so that you have a better understanding of what's actually happening with your vehicle and so that you can make a better, more informed tuning and upgrading choice. As always, thanks all for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4HR.